Two things. You see our motto in church planting, which has been our motto since day one. Every EPC church, a parent, a partner, or a patron of church planting. And I just want to remind us that are here live and also those that are here with us virtually that one of the key ways that our leadership team tries to measure success in church planting is not just the number of active church plants we have at any given time, but how many of our churches, existing churches, are supporting church planting, supporting through investing financially, investing in prayer, investing in keeping your eyes open for the next generation of church planters. We believe we will be, part of our success will be measured by close to 100% participation in church planting. The other half of that screen is where I began earlier, is that's what church planting used to look like. It used to look like gathering, lots of folks together, sharing the gospel, beginning to build community within a larger community and growing congregations. Clearly, the last 18 months have been a challenge for us in that area. So on the next screen, you see what church planting has looked like in the last 14 months. Now you might say, Tom, that little guy kind of looks like you. That's one of my grandsons. That's why he looks like me. He was actually upset that they weren't having gummy bears for breakfast. But that face kind of is the face of a lot of our emotions for the last year, is it not? And you notice the sign outside of a church door that the church building was closed because of COVID. You see the masks there. The last 18 months have been a challenge. And if they've been a challenge for our traditional churches, they've certainly been a challenge for our church plants. I know as a pastor that serves with a staff of about 12 different individuals, there are moments when I feel terribly alone as a pastor. And take that and place that into a scenario where you are the only staff member. You are the church planter. You are the session. You are the setup takedown team. You are the communication department, and then isolate that person for 18 months. It has been a real challenge. Praise God. We have lost very few of our church plants. Our folks are, metaphorically speaking, still standing, but it has been a real challenge. So I want to encourage everybody who is hearing my voice. If you don't regularly pray for church planting in the EPC, I understand that. It's out there. You don't always think about it. But I would really strongly ask you to make a note to be praying for our church planters. At this point in my presentation, I'm going to stop talking to you live, and I want you to watch the screen. And we're going to tell you very briefly two stories of current church planting in the EPC. When you think of EPC church planting, what comes to mind? Multi-ethnic urban settings, house churches, underserved communities, a new congregation meeting in a grade school cafeteria, worship in a variety of language. It's all of this and more. EPC church planting in 2021 represents the greater American landscape more than ever before. A small group of Brazilian residents in North Philadelphia. A house church led by the owners of Lazarus Brewing Company in Austin, Texas. A multiracial congregation beginning to grow in Ferguson, Missouri. From Jacksonville to Detroit, Denver to Pittsburgh, Chicago to Seattle, over 50 active EPC church plants are being planted in a wide range of neighborhoods and communities, all for the purpose of sharing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today we're going to visit two of our newer church plants. All Souls Church in North Nashville, pastored by veteran church planter Kirk Atkinson, and Port Orchard, Washington church plant of Chapel Hill, led by one of our younger church planting pastors, Megan Hackman. Both are unique, and both have a common bond of sharing Jesus with love, transparency, and kindness. This is EPC Church Planting 2021.
Well, hello, EPCGA. I'm Kirk Atkinson. I'm the pastor, the church planting pastor of All Souls Church of Nashville. My wife Deb and I moved here in August of 2017, and we moved to Nashville to plant a diverse church in North Nashville, kind of the last part of the city to be gentrified. When we moved here, gentrification had just started, and it has wreaked havoc. So much of it has been a struggle for those who've lived in North Nashville for decades. But we're trying to figure out what it looks like to be a church that ministers to long-term residents who are under-resourced, and what it looks like to experience gentrification, but have a church that really lives and breathes the kingdom of God right there in that space. I have a lot of people who ask me about planting a diverse church. A diverse church ethnically, economically, and culturally. And it's not easy, but it's something that we need. We need churches that look like the communities in our cities. So what do? Well, we have to be in love with the gospel. In love with the gospel that brings us salvation, and a gospel that changes us and gives us a kingdom view of the world. That the gospel is good news for the poor, it's good news for the prisoner, it's good news for the brokenhearted, it's good news for those who are hurting and need healing. I am so excited about church planting in the EPC. There's hardly a better way to influence your city for the gospel, to see people come to know the Lord, and to do gospel ministry than to plant churches. So pray for all of us as we do that.
The reason that we're planting a church in Port Orchard hasn't changed, but how we're going about it certainly has. I'm Megan, and I pastor Chapel Hill, Port Orchard, and we were expected to launch on Easter Sunday of 2020. Things changed. That's okay. I think instinctively, I wouldn't have put words to this, but the vision before this year was that the whole town would come and be here in this sanctuary. But what I've gotten a vision for this year is that instead of the whole town coming into our church, the vision is for our whole church to get into our town. We saw Jesus spend most of his life in three places: in the sanctuary, in the home, in different people's homes having meals, and walking along the way. And I just wonder, for us as pastors, which are we most likely to neglect? The walking along the way, the walking with people. But COVID drove me to my neighborhood. It drove me into my home. It drove me onto my road. And now that we're a year in and we are gathering in this sanctuary, the people speaking into my sermon are actually my neighbors, none of whom have come into the sanctuary. I don't know when or if they will, but they're walking and talking the sermon with me now because I spent this year walking and talking with them. When we came back together, my vision cast to them was to do a 2021 challenge. Give $20 away and spend 21 minutes walking the 1 mile radius around your house. What that means is that if there are 40 people gathering in the congregation, 40 square miles of Port Orchard were walked and prayed over in this last year. So it's been a hard year, but it's been a good one. And I'm really glad to still be on mission here in Port Orchard. Thank you for your support. And I hope you feel encouraged that if the mission of God has you walking in your neighborhood a whole lot more than gathering together, I hope you can see that you are still called to the same place and still imitating Jesus in the way you are doing church. Bless you.
Megan and Kirk represent a new generation of gospel-centered, missional church planting pastors in the EPC. I wish we had enough time to tell you about some of our other 50 active church plants around the country. As our church planting model becomes more diverse and reaches into communities that reflect the changing landscape of America, we praise God for their passion to impact all peoples with the message of grace and redemption through our Lord Jesus. So in just a couple minutes, let me wrap up by telling you what we're looking at going into the future. We're going to be focusing in on the pipeline, on identifying the next generation of church planters. That continues to be a key need. There are several opportunities for church planting right now that are waiting for church planters to take those roles. And so We will continue to use our fall retreat. Last year, we had to pivot very quickly with COVID, and we ended up doing Zoom seminars throughout the fall and throughout the winter. We spent the money that we would normally spend on the retreat and in other things, resourcing COVID-related needs within our church plants. Some of those needs were physical. Some of those needs were spiritual. We invested quite a bit of money in our church planters getting help, getting counseling if they needed it individually or in their marriage. We wanted to make sure that we took care of kind of our frontline folks. And so we're going to continue to be focusing on growing the next generation of church planters. And then as we look to the future, we want to make sure that hopefully you've heard this from us a lot, but if you haven't heard, I want you here today. We don't plant churches nationally. We plant churches locally. So our national team is not a group of people that go around and tell folks what to do in church planting. Our national team is committed to being a resource, to being a service platform for you in your local setting to successfully plant churches. So creating networks, support structures, assessment. We did a mini assessment 2 days before GA started here in Memphis this week. We assessed a couple of church planters, ongoing coaching, help with fundraising, demographic studies, leadership diagnostics. You see all of that on the screen. And so we are continuing to try to put into place the mechanisms, the infrastructure that is needed so that as we recruit the next generation of church planters, as we bring them along, we want to empower them. We want to give them the human tools they need as God has gifted them divinely in order for them to be successful at church planting. So I saw on the schedule that David Strunk, one of our national team leaders, is going to pray for us. I'm going to ask every church planter that's in the room or network leader that is in the room, if you would please stand up wherever you are. And if you're close by them and you're comfortable doing this, would you mind laying hands on them as Dave leads us in prayer for our church planters? I'll get out of the way.
Let's pray. Our Father, we ask that your Spirit would be palpably present to our church planters and the over 50 of them in the EPC. That you would provide encouragement where there's discouragement, that you would provide comfort where there has been turmoil, that you would provide energy where there has been lethargy. Would you give them favor in their meeting spaces? Would you give them favor with friendships inside and outside their congregation? Would you give them proto-elders who can walk alongside them and care about the ministry just as much as they do? Would you help their ministry flourish? Would you give them visible success in the next year that they could actually say, wow, what I'm doing and partnering with you is making a difference? Would you make it visible? Would you flourish this work through the EPC and to the ends of the earth? We give you thanks for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you guys for praying with them. And then lastly, if you have questions, if you want to talk to us, if you want to grab me and talk about church planting, I'm around during GA. But you can also find us on the EPC website. Reach out to us at any point during the year. We're happy to engage with you on any way we can to help church planting. That concludes my report. Thank you.